So welcome to this episode of I'm here with the Brighton Dolphin project. So we've got Thea Taylor and we've got Simon McPherson. Welcome to the vote. What's the Brighton Dolphin project? Maybe we start off with Thea.
So Brighton Dolphin project is the first comprehensive study of marine mammals on the Sussex coastline. We also work to promote ecological issues, working with schools, doing outreach projects and stuff like that. But my side is more the research.
Yeah.
Doing the actual study of what's out there and what have we got off our coastline.
Yeah, and there's a lot out there, isn't there? A lot, but most people would be surprised.
There's a lot more than people think. It's
people would be surprised that we've got dolphins that are off the coast, because they've been there are sightings sometimes, aren't there? But they're not that well reported, and people don't really necessarily read the reports.
Yeah, no, it's quite hard to find information on what dolphins we've got out there. We actually have four species of cetacean, which is the collective name for whales, dolphins, and porpoises. So there's plenty out there, and bottlenose dolphins, which are the iconic dolphin species, are the ones that are most commonly seen off Sussex coast.
So. Yeah. So Simon, what's your role at the Dolphin Project?
So my role is the project coordinator. So I basically oversee all of the day-to-day activities and running of the projects as well, including the research aspect of the project as well. It's a role I've been doing now since October.
Yeah.
Last.
And how did it come about then? Why does Brighton need a Dolphin Project?
We need a dolphin project because actually our city has an incredibly rich heritage with these animals. If you walk along, there's lots of dolphin imagery, particularly on the bandstand. As well, when you consider events such as the dolphins being held at the Brighton Aquarium in the 60s, it's clear that the city does have a connection to these animals.
Yeah.
But we feel as though actually the whole of Sussex has actually lost the connection to these animals. So we feel as though it's our duty to remind everybody of what's out there. What can be done to safeguard them?
Yeah. And why are they under threat? What are the key reasons? Because they are under threat. And it's a busy channel, really, isn't it?
So the English Channel is actually one of the busiest stretches of sea in the world.
Yeah.
You've got commercial shipping, you've got fishing activity, obviously, and then just recreational boat users as well. Just this afternoon, there was 8 jet skis off the pier. So it's important that people know that the dolphins are out there so they can look out for them and avoid things like boat collisions.
Yeah. And what else? What are the other threats? Are there environmental threats? Maybe the fishermen or...?
Yeah, obviously. We've had a lot of reports of harbour porpoise in the past becoming entangled in fishermen's nets. There's a lot of work involving things like pingers, which are acoustic devices, to try and prevent this from happening. But it does still happen. Common dolphins also have washed up with signs of being entangled in fishing nets.
Yeah.
So it is a big issue in the channel.
Yeah, and so what does your project, what does it aim to do? What are the key aims to it? And, what does your day-to-day activity look like?
So we aim to inspire and engage the local community about Sussex marine ecosystems and species that can be found along the Sussex coastline, whilst also highlighting the actions that can be taken to support marine conservation. So on a day-to-day basis, we run our Dolphin Discovery Centre, which is based along the little promenade by the Brighton Palace Pier. And we run activities including a dolphin VR watching experience, and we've got artifacts on display from the Booth Museum as well. With the research project, our ultimate aim is to basically study the distribution and abundance of marine mammals in Sussex so we can find out more about what's out there and so action can be taken to safeguard their future.
Yeah. Are you working with any other organisations? There's quite a few, there's a marine conservation zone, as we were discussing off air, next to Brighton Marina. So do you work with... Natural England or any of the other government agencies?
We go to the meetings of IFCA, which is a collection of organisations in Sussex that work to manage the seas off Sussex. But we also have got data with Sea-Watch that we share data with, and also we're working at the moment to establish a dolphin spotting point for National Whale and Dolphin Week with Sea-Watch as well. So that should be good.
Yeah, because are there any areas off the coast where you can actually go and you're virtually guaranteed to see a dolphin? We were just talking off there about Alaska. You can almost guarantee to see whales in certain parts of Alaska.
Unfortunately, Sussex is not quite Alaska.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a case of luck, but there are definite zones. The area between Brighton and Worthing is one of the most popular areas that dolphins are seen, particularly we're noticing around the wind farm, now that it's finished all the noise of the construction,
yeah.
We are noticing significantly higher numbers in these areas. So around Brighton and Worthing, and we've also had sightings off Shoreham, obviously, and New Haven and Seaford as well.
Yeah, and who gives you information about those sightings? Do you have certain kind of a membership which, you know...
It's all members of the public.
Okay.
So if anyone's out on their boat, or even just walking along the shore, they take a photo or a video, try and document how many individuals there were in the group, take a guess at the species, where they were, what they were doing, time and date, and then they send that information in to us.
Right.
We have research leaflets that normally go out to all the marinas with a little bit more information on, a bit of an ID guide. So any boat users coming into the marina can pick up those and go out and collect some data for us.
And there's two species of dolphin, aren't there, that can be found by and large off the coast, is that right?
There's actually four.
There's four.
Two
right, okay.
are a lot less common.
Yeah.
So you've got the white-beaked, which is more of an oceanic species.
Yeah.
And they're found right in the middle of the channel. The nearest sighting was 18 miles off Brighton.
Yeah.
And then you've got the common Atlantic dolphin. And that's a temperate species, so it only turns up here when the water gets a lot warmer towards
yeah.
the end of summer. The bottlenose dolphin is the iconic, you know, the standard dolphin almost. It's the one that everyone associates with things like flipper. And they're here all year round.
Yeah.
But obviously more people are out in the summer, so they get to see them more. And then we also have the harbour porpoise, which is my favourite little cetacean. They only get up to about 1.8 metres long. Very small, very shy, but they are here all year round as well.
Yeah. How can people find... If you wanted to look at dolphins, which a lot of people do, is there any... What can they do to increase their chances of, you know, seeing them?
Get out on the water more.
Get out on the water more.
That's it, yeah.
Right.
Get out on the water.
And you organise tours, don't you,
for
that
yeah.
reason?
Mm.
So. Tell us a bit about that, Simon.
So we organise boat tours throughout the summer departing from Brighton Marina, where it's a chance for you to learn about marine wildlife in Sussex and enjoy a connection to nature. They depart from Brighton Marina and we run two different types of trips. There's a sunset wildlife trip where you go out to the West Pier and you see the sun setting over Brighton. And we also run a two-hour trip where you go out to the Rampion Wind Farm. We learn more about why wind farms are important, a way of preventing activities such as climate change,
yeah.
etc. They've proven to be very popular to the point at one point we even had to open up extra tickets, didn't we? And they all completely sold out, which is obviously a really good indication that people like to do these sort of activities. What we always say to people is that whilst dolphin sighting this close to shore are rare, we do certainly keep our eyes peeled. But there'll always be a friendly wildlife guide on board who'll be there on hand
yes.
to tell you about what you're seeing.
Where can people find out more information about that?
So they can find out more information on our website, www.brightondolphinproject.org as well.
Yeah.
And all the details are there. For the sunset cruise, it's £25 for an adult and £18 for a child. And for the wind farm cruise, it's £60 for an adult and £50 for a child. But we do advise early booking because the spaces do fill very quickly, as we have recently discovered from this
yeah.
first year of running boat trips.
You mentioned climate change. We can talk about a lot more about that in the second half because we're going to get warmer waters. Does that encourage more dolphins? Are we going to see more dolphins off the coast in years to come?
We don't know.
Right.
the climate change is... We don't know what's going to happen in the future. This is why it's such a scary thing. We don't know how it's going to impact. We know the water's going to get warmer, but then we're also thinking that the Gulf Stream might change, which might mean that we get less warm water.
Yeah.
So the Gulf Stream comes up from Mexico and brings the water, you know, our warm water. But if that
yeah.
changes course, it might mean that we end up getting colder water from the Atlantic. So it's we'll have to see what happens in the future.
Yeah. Where do the dolphins, where do they go, like, for the rest of the year than the ones that are here?
We don't know.
You don't know?
So, because this is really the first
Genetic
year...
Project.
Yeah.
exactly,
this
yeah.
is really the first year of yeah. us studying them. There isn't a photo ID catalogue. There isn't any historical data. We're really, like, pioneering this in Sussex. So we're trying to establish connections with organisations. I've been in contact with Charlie Phillips up in the Moray Firth.
Yeah.
Obviously, Sea-Watch, they do a lot of work across the UK and organisations in France as well.
Yeah. OK. Well, just quickly before we break for the first half, why do you think we've got a fascination with dolphins? Because there is that kind of fascination. It's a bit like the panda, isn't it? Panda bear.
Yeah, they're an incredibly charismatic animal and they're incredibly intelligent. They have similar family structures to humans. Empathy is along the same level. Their intelligence is extraordinary. They're one of the few other animals that we know use tools for an effect.
Yeah.
So yeah, there's just this connection. It's almost unexplained, but we see a lot of similarities between people and cetaceans.
They talk to each other, don't they? There's evidence of them talking.
Yeah, they do. They have their own names called signature whistles.
Yeah.
It's like them walking into a car and going, "Hi, I'm Steve." You know, it's like that. For example, killer whales, which we don't get here before anyone gets excited.
Yeah.
Killer whales are known to have their own dialects. They have their own languages between different pods. And they have their own cultures as well. So they're an incredibly fascinating group of animals. And I could talk about them all day. So.
Okay, we'll leave it there for now. Join us for the second half where we'll be talking about dolphin intelligence and also a bit more about the Brighton Dolphin Project. So welcome back to the Vote. I'm here with Thea and with Simon from the Brighton Dolphin Project. Dolphin intelligence, we chatted about it in the first half.
Yeah.
So tell us a bit more about that and the family structure that they have and how they communicate, because it's fascinating.
It is fascinating. And I mean, it varies between species, but with odontocetes, which is toothed whales, so things like the dolphin family, they have a quite strong family network. Things like killer whales have their own languages, their own culture, their own dialects between different pods, which is different groups of animals. They're mainly led by a matriarchal society, so they have a boss female, and then her daughters all stay with her and the males kind of go off and do their own thing.
Yeah.
Bottlenose dolphins form like bachelor pods of males. So they, when they get to kind of breeding age, they all congregate together and disappear off and go and find other females from separate pods. They have their own names, so signature whistles. The way they hunt, they all communicate between each other.
Yeah.
It's really fascinating.
Yeah, I've seen that on the, my knowledge is obviously from David Attenborough,
yes,
like, you know,
of course.
98% of the population. 98% of the population get their knowledge from these hunts. So yeah, they're really how they hunt is fascinating. It's a pack, isn't it? It's like a pack. And
yeah.
But whales do the same thing, don't they, as well? Humpback whales. Yeah,
they do. So they form bubble networks. So one will go around the outside, making a really high-pitched noise.
Yeah.
And emitting bubbles out of its blowhole, and then all the others will come up underneath and lunge feed. So it's quite a spectacular sight if you're ever lucky enough to see it.
So where else do we see dolphins apart from the Sussex coast? Obviously they're globally,
they're
aren't
global.
They? Are there any particular areas which you guys are interested in apart from Sussex?
It depends what you want to see and where you want to go.
Yeah.
New Zealand fascinates me. Because I'm particularly interested in killer whales, which you don't get here, as I said. I'm particularly interested in killer whales, and they have several different pods in New Zealand, all that have their own different cultural history, and they're all on the verge of being considered subspecies because they don't breed, because they can't understand each other.
You're right.
So I'm very interested in that. Australia is on the route of the humpback whale migration. You've got the west of America for grey whales, that's their migration route, particularly in Baja California, they're quite well known there.
Yeah.
And then up north in the Arctic for the herring season is spectacular. You get killer whales, minke whales, humpback whales, it's quite a sight.
Yeah, so who would dolphins predators be off the Sussex coast? Are there any predators? Are they relatively safe? From
aside from humans, we don't have anything that would eat dolphins off Sussex. It depends on what species and where you are.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. What's the future look like for the Brighton Dolphin Project, Simon? What's the next few months? What have you got? I know you're working with Paddle Round the Pier.
We are, yes. We are going to be at Paddle Round the Pier.
Yeah. So what's that involve?
So we're going to have a stand where we're going to talk a little bit more about our work, and we're also launching what we call a ghost gear challenge, where we've got a old fishing net, which is clean, by the way. And what the idea is, you can dress up as a sea creature, such as a shark or a turtle, and go underneath this fishing net to see how fast you can escape from it, to give you the idea of what it'd be like if you were a shark or a turtle trapped in this fishing net as well. But actually, there's a really bright future for us. The community response has been amazing for us, and there's so much going on in terms of inside the project and outside the project as well. I guess our ultimate aim would be to have this community of ocean champions in Sussex, so essentially anyone who feels empowered to take the right steps for marine conservation as well. So, yeah, lots of exciting discussions.
And do you work with the fishing industry, for example?
We're trying to.
Yeah. That would be ideal, wouldn't
it? We have several fishermen that have submitted data to us.
Yeah.
But we found them a little bit cautious because there's a lot of animal activist groups out there, and dolphins and seals are almost seen as a pest to some fishermen. They're seen as taking their fish, they damage their nets, things like that. So we're doing it more on a we just want to know what's there basis instead of kind of a protection. Because from the research side, that is all we want. We want to know what's there, when they're there. And what species we've got. So that's that's what we're trying to approach the fishermen with.
Yeah. What do dolphins what do they do at night? Where do they I mean, how do they sleep? And
they sleep with half a brain at a time.
Right.
We think.
So it was a good question.
Yeah. From what we can tell, they only sleep with half their brain. So they're always kind of alert, but they perform what's called logging, which is where they just rest at the surface. They don't exert any behaviour really, but they're still alert. They're still kind of half awake.
It's while sleeping.
It's a bit like when you wake up in the morning before you've had coffee. Not really doing much, but still kind of alert to what's going on, alert for danger.
And your area of responsibility, you were talking about dolphins 18 miles off the coast. So you're going to work with the French authorities because we're getting on towards France there, aren't we?
Yes. So that is our hope and our plan. Yeah. We're doing a lot of research on what organisations are working over there, what data they have, and we're hoping to collaborate with them in the future.
Yeah. And just lastly, I mean, are there any dolphins that are endangered? You know, have you been working with the authorities on that?
Not in Sussex.
Right. But globally, on a global scale?
Globally, there are a lot of populations that are endangered. I think the most well-known is the vaquita, which is a type of porpoise in the Gulf of Mexico. And as far as we know, there's 12 left.
A recent study was there's approximately 12 left in the entire world.
Right.
The main danger is that the fishermen out in Mexico, they basically just discard their fishing nets off the side of the boats. And no one goes to pick it up. And essentially, the vaquitas, they basically become entangled inside these fishing nets, and then they sadly pass away. Right. But it is an issue that more people are starting to become more aware of. And as much as we would like to be involved in the conservation of the vaquita, it's a bit too specialist, a bit too far away for us. But although we do work in Sussex, we do certainly care about the conservation of all well-known species of whales, dolphins and porpoises across the world.
Yeah. So the vaquita dolphin, are they in captivity? Any of those? I guess there's both genders, a male and female, so they can have a breeding program.
They don't thrive very well in captivity,
right?
Unfortunately, there has been attempts at getting a breeding program set up, but it hasn't been very successful so far.
Right. Just before we wrap up, climate change. I mean, what can we? Big topic, I know. So what are the threats from, you know, from global warming, you know, potentially on the dolphin population? If you can do that in about 2 minutes.
In about 2 minutes. In about 2 minutes, the straight answer is we can't predict the future. We'd love to be able to, but I mean, obviously some people are predicting that the ocean's going to get warmer where we are. Some people are predicting that the Gulf Stream's going to change, which means we'll get colder water. In general, the ecosystem is going to change, and it's whether the animals in it can adapt fast enough to be able to deal with it.
I mean, one thing is all of the rubbish, the garbage in the ocean. Yes. Mm. I know that, to be fair, Sky, you know, the Sky, the project that they're doing on Sky Oceans project, they've really highlighted that, haven't they?
Yeah, they've done a fantastic
job of doing that.
Highlighting that. In fact, the other week we did a beach clean and just out on Brighton Beach within a 24-hour period, you know, 20 kilos of rubbish were removed.
Yeah, should mention that we Brighton Beach Clean just before we finish up. So how can people get involved in that?
So we run what we call a 2-minute beach clean. So you can literally pick up a litter picker and a bucket and go out and do your little 2-minute beach clean as well. We work closely with organisations such as the Marine Conservation Society to run beach cleans as well. But it's a really good positive way to play your part in tackling what is a global issue on your local patch of beach.
Yeah, and where do they run from the beach cleans? Is that just on Brighton?
So they mainly, the Marine Conservation Society, they do the ones throughout the UK, and we're hoping to organise some of our own ones that we can do along the Sussex coastline.
Yeah, as well. So where can people go again if you want to give your details?
So the best place to find out more details about what we do is go on our website. We are also on social media, so we're on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram as well. So be sure to give us a follow on there as well if you can.
Great, OK. Thanks for coming in today.
Thank you.
Yeah, all the best in the future, and I'm sure we'll catch up again soon.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you for having us.
Thanks.